Also, I went over to Saudi Arabia this week and went up to the original Mount Sinai and found the original burning bush. It's right here. In a little while, it's not the original, I don't think. So I found it behind the baptistry. All right. But this is our burning bush for today. And I think you're going to enjoy this, but we're going to do that a little bit later. So if you're trying to figure out what in the world is that? Well, just hang on. That's what we're going to have there, and that's what we're going to be looking at, Exodus 3. Let's pray and thank God for everything. Amen. And we're getting ready to take the offering, too, so I'll just pray for our offering right now. And thank you for your faithfulness in giving and helping us, and I just appreciate that so very much. Father, I do pray for the folks in North Carolina, Virginia, Father, all this terrible storm that people are out. And God, I thank you for the gifts that we were able to collect Wednesday night to send to Samaritan's Purse. And Lord, I pray anyone else might have that today. God, may we do all we can to help others. And Father, thank you for allowing everything that's going on today. Nothing's taking you by surprise. Help us, God. This is the day the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you, Father. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you that the burning bush doesn't need to be plugged into anything because it's all about you. Thank you, Lord, that any old bush will do because that's irrelevant. It's not the bush. It's the fire in the bush. Thank you, Father. Teach us, help us as we worship you today. As we take this offering, it's because you gave yourself to us. It's why we give everything we can back to you, Lord. Thank you, Father. I pray, Father, for my cousin today, Becky, and her husband, Mark. I know they were so thrilled about getting this new lung. And yesterday, just before they did the surgery, they found out the lung was not usable. And Lord, thank you that when we go through disappointments, that a death of a vision doesn't mean it's over yet. You're going to use it for good. Thank you for all you do. Bless them. Put your arms around them. Thank you, Lord. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Oh, I can't even hear that first little part without getting excited. That's my favorite right there. Oh, thank you, Brother Bryant, choir. Just a couple quick announcements today. We have October as Clergy Appreciation Month. Take a note here in your bulletin. It is October. It's a special time that congregations set aside to honor their pastors for their hard work and sacrificial dedication to the Lord and to the people of God. So, Brother Dan, we love you. We love you, sir. Thank you for all you do for us. And just take time at some point this month to come by, see him and Miss Jeannie. You know, extend a hearty handshake, a big hug, maybe a gift. Either way, we're just very thankful for you guys. We have our biblical church leadership, okay? Church members, this is a big deal now, okay? Listen to me. There's a little card in your bulletin. It's for nominating deacons, all right? You may think, I don't know how to do that. I don't know the qualifications. If you know a man of God who goes to church and isn't a deacon, write their name down. Either it works out or it doesn't, but either way, it's good for you to give your opinion on that prayerfully, okay? What we have is, you fill out the card with 3 to 5 names of men you feel led to nominate. You place your nomination card in the chest of Joash. It's right back there by the door, all right? And you have one more week to get this done, okay? You have this Sunday, you have all the way until next Sunday to put your votes in there, and then that's when the deacons and Brother Dan will have their prayer and go through the process of deciding who's going to come on the deacon board, all right? Very important stuff. Also, know this, Grief Share Ministry is going fantastic. Brother Dave, our sister Kim, they are so active in that. Every Monday night, they've been meeting in the common room just next to us here. 6:30 to 8 p.m., and I'm telling you something, it's just people who have gone through loss, which is all of us at some point, but loving each other in the name of the Lord, helping them through that pain, and it is so powerful, okay? And I've said this before, but even if you who have known loss may not think, maybe you think, oh, I don't need a group. I don't need to do that. Maybe they need you. Maybe you need to come and extend a hand and a prayerful time with these folks who could be lifted up by your encouragement and faith, okay? So think about that, Monday at 6:30. Of course, we have our men's prayer time on Tuesday mornings at 9 a.m. Please do come. It is a powerful time. Men of God in that room, donuts and coffee, of course. But really, it's just lifting up our country, all right? And that's so important, especially right now, lifting up our families, our youth, our church. So please come if you can, gentlemen. It's super powerful. We have our Wednesday. Okay, this is special. This next one is special. It's only going to go on for a couple of weeks. So for the next three Wednesdays at 5 p.m., there will be a special prayer room time. We're going to be praying for our nation, okay, right as we lead up to the election. So please do, if you can, there's going to be a special coordinated time of prayer. They will be praying this Wednesday at this Wednesday the 9th, the 16th, and the 23rd, the next three Wednesdays at 5 p.m., and it's just going to be powerful. And even if you can't come here, wherever you are, set an alarm on your phone, 5 p.m. We're lifting up our nation together every Wednesday for the next 3 weeks, okay? All right, well, we have our Awana Fall Festival coming up right there on October 30th, our outdoor Awana Fall Festival. If you'd like to help, please see Chelsea or Nathan. We have three more Sundays and three more Wednesdays to bring candy. If you can donate some candy, make sure it's individually wrapped candies, you know what I'm saying? No bowls of M&Ms or anything. But please do, if you can, bring some for that. And if you want to help, we'd love to have a hand. And other than that, just Wednesday night fellowship. Come eat with us at 5:15. Stay. Adult Bible study is at 6:30. We're in the book of Daniel. Got youth. We got children's events. And it's powerful. I'm telling you what. Sometimes it's better than Sunday morning because you have fellowship and inclusion and all these folks just lending a hand. And it's good stuff. You know, it's good to sit there and look this way. But it's even better to get in there and get going. You know what I mean? Yeah, okay. Well, hey, you know what we're going to do? Let's just take 2 minutes. And let's have a time of welcoming. That's the best part, I think, besides the sermon. Go ahead and take a stand with us right now. Just for a minute, we're going to greet each other, all right? All right.
I'm strong when I'm on your shoulders. You raise me up to be more than I can be. Thank you.
You raise me up. It really fits in with what we're looking at this morning. And you might turn the sound down. It sounds a little bit loud now for some reason. So I'll just pull it down here so I won't blow your ears out. Last week we talked about the basket that Moses was in, and how Jochebed, his mother, and of course his father Amram were involved in this for 3 months, couldn't keep him hid, so they put him in the Nile River. They may have shoved it out. I don't know what, the Bible doesn't tell us exactly. The current would have taken it anyway. Crocodiles and all that, and of course, that's what Pharaoh told them to do, is take your newborns and throw them into the Nile, thinking they would drown or be eaten with crocodiles there. So, and then the princess finds him, as you know. We talked about that last week. And now, you know, chapter 2 of Exodus covers 80 years of his life. I mean, boom, it just goes pretty quick. At age 40, he kills an Egyptian. He's ready to become a leader. He's trained in all the ways of Pharaoh. He's trained to be another Pharaoh, Moses is. And so everything is going in that direction. And I tell you what, would you all turn the lights down? I want folks to see our burning bush here with the lights out, because it just turn every light off in here, if you don't mind. Yeah, turn these off too up here. There we go. So this is our burning bush. So don't get too close, all right? So take your shoes off if you get up here. Okay, so that's all right. Turn it back on now. I just kind of wanted you to see this. Oh, I have no idea what that was. Oh, I thought someone got shot. So, but praise the Lord. I just wanted to, the message this morning is in chapter 3 is any old bush will do. God is not really concerned with the bush. I mean, that was probably an acacia bush, and acacia bushes are all over the desert. They produce tremendous thorns, and I'll talk about that in a moment. But so we see that. So let me start this message today. As we looked at last week, he was at age 80. You know, here he is. He's got married. He runs away from Egypt at age 40. And now he goes and meets Reuel, who is Jethro. Most of you know him by Jethro. And now becomes his father-in-law because he marries the oldest daughter, Zipporah. And they have a son, and who means banishment and set apart, which probably is because that's kind of what he was done. They set him apart, etc. So all this is happening, but now he turns aside and goes up because he sees a bush burning that doesn't consume itself. He's seen probably many bushes burn. That's quite common in desert areas where you have spontaneous combustion with lots of heat, et cetera, and dryness of the bush, et cetera. But this is a bush that does not burn up. So it's the fire in the bush that matters. And that's pretty well what I want to talk to you about this morning and go over. So I put in your notes an introduction. I hope it will help you. I wrote a few things here. And if you don't mind, I like to just read it because that way I don't skip anything. But the Lord really kind of laid on my heart to do this. I tell you what the situation was. I'm not sure exactly what day it was. It might have been Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday. I can't remember the exact day, to be quite honest. But normally I get up fairly early and start work there in my office at home and do things. And then 3 days a week I run down to the and swim for a little while and then come to the office. I try to be here around 6 or so in the morning. But I woke up just as... I mean, boom, there's no way I'd go back to sleep. And I was pretty tired. I had gone through a lot of things, but I just woke up. It was 3 o'clock in the morning. And I just thought, well, okay, I won't go back to bed. I'm awake. Might as well just get on with it. And so I always take a bath at night, so I don't take a shower in the morning because a lot of times I go swimming too. Then I have to take a shower. Get the chlorine off of you and all that stuff. But needless to say, I came down here. I got here probably about 3:30, and it was kind of a burning bush moment for me. It was a time in my study that God began to really speak to me. And, you know, I wish I could say that happens every week. It's been a while. But the Lord really began to speak to me, and I wrote down some things that the Lord was speaking to me about, and that's your introduction for today. So I hope that will help you. When God calls you, how do you respond? Do you make excuses running in the opposite direction? In this study from the book of Exodus chapter 3, we see the Lord present Moses calling. This calling is really on a silver platter for all of us. As we examine his encounter at the burning bush, let's explore. I want to see 5 common excuses. Now, we're only going to look at 2 of those today because of time. But next week, we'll finish this out. These excuses that Moses gives for not obeying God. You know, really, folks, here's what God laid on my heart. I don't know if I got this put in your notes or not, but I'm going to read it to you. The whole point of the Christian life is focused on one point. And you say, well, what's that, Pastor Dan? Well, it's your personal, now this might sound like a strange word, confrontation. God's going to confront you. He confronted me this week in a very true sense. Your personal confrontation with God. All of the other personalities, activities, emotions, institutions of faith, Christian faith, they lose any meaning apart they just from the confrontation with God so that we can see him as he really is. A singular encounter with God was all that Moses needed. He didn't need anything else. The mountain with the bush that burned without burning out. The circumstances that led Moses to that moment have their parallel in Dan Maxwell and you in our lives. God comes to us today with the same methods he came to Moses with. Nothing's changed. He's going to tell you and me both to take our shoes off and see if God can use any old bush. Amen. Amen. He can do it. The living God always takes the initiative, amen, to confront you and me as he is. We have to have the courage to see him as he is and let the conviction of the Spirit of God speak to us. So let me read some of the text to you here. Psalm chapter 3, verse 1. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the back of the desert, and he came to Horeb. People ask me, what's the difference between Horeb and Mount Sinai? Horeb is the mountain range. It's the area that Mount Sinai is the major mountain in. So when you say Horeb or Mount Sinai, you're pretty well saying the same thing. They call it the mountain of God. So here it just says mountain of God. But the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of the bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. Then Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. And so I was just goofing around with you when I said I went to Saudi Arabia. I mean, they don't let you do that. But that's where the real Mount Sinai is. But God chooses Moses for this. Moses, you know, he's 80 years old when this happens. He's been a shepherd for 40 years. Now, Moses considered himself, I'm sure, a failure. He was going to be the next Pharaoh. He was trained. The Bible tells us that in Acts chapter 7, Stephen says, you know, he was being trained to be the next Pharaoh. He had it all going his way. But then he kills this Egyptian, and he knows that that's death, so he runs away. And, he was ready to be God's flaming evangelist. He said, I'm ready to lead you guys out. He saw the Egyptian beating up a Hebrew, and he was protecting the Hebrew and ended up killing this guy. So but let me say this to you. That was a death of a vision. Just as my cousin and her husband, they were all set, ready to get this new lung. Everything was going. They had him prepped. They're getting ready to pull out. We just had our Bible study down here for the men. I went up there, and all of a sudden the doctor came in, sat on the bed with him, and said, the lung is no good. It was not just them, but there was another family there waiting for a lung transplant, and neither one of these lungs were any good. It was a death of a vision. And after my comforting my cousin, I tried my best. Mark pretty well took it in stride, but I know they were both disappointed. But I said, you know, this is a death of a vision. But God always has, he has the last chapter in this deal. I mean, don't worry. God has the way of working all things together for good. Didn't say they're all good, but they all work towards good, the Bible says. God has now put Moses in the greatest seminary in the world. It is the Desert Theological Seminary. He's about to finish his degree, his BSD degree, Backside of the Desert degree. And he's going to graduate with honors. So praise the Lord. And so God prepared us in a humbling activity. I mean, God, that's how he does it. He's 80 years old, and he doesn't own any sheep. These are his father-in-law's sheep. He owns nothing. And, you know, he's just for 40 years, he's on the backside of the desert taking care of sheep. What's God doing? It's a death of a vision. He was going to be God's flaming evangelist at age 40. He's going to lead the people out. At age 80, he's a broken down shepherd way out there in the desert. And he's never, the actual Hebrew construction of these words said that he was further away than he had ever been before at this place. So God prepares us in humbling activities. Amen. At age 80 years old, he is still leading his father's sheep, his father-in-law's sheep. He sees himself as a failure. You know, pastors sometimes look around at other pastors and they start, you know, pointing at themselves and they seem like a failure. I heard this story, this man, it was Sunday morning, and his wife walks into the bedroom and he's still in bed. It's time to get ready for church. And she said, why don't you get, honey, you need to get up and get your clothes on. It's time to go to church. And he said, no, I'm not going today. She said, why? She finally said, give me three reasons why you're not going to go. And he said, well, I can do that. That's easy. Number one, he says, The people are cold and uncaring. Second reason is that nobody likes me there. And then number three said, I just don't feel like it. So she looks at him and said, I'm going to give you three reasons why you should go. Number one, the church is warm and inviting and sensitive. Number two, there are a few people there who like you. And number three reason, you're the pastor. My point is this. I bet the whole Moses might have felt like that, amen? But God finally got a hold of him and said, you're the pastor. You're the guy I'm going to use, yeah? Broken, beat down, can't go anymore. That's all right. I've got you right where I want you. And so this was all part of the deal. So we're going to see here Moses' commission in this dry, desolate place here. So for 40 years as the shepherd, same sheep, same smell. I mean, he's out there in the heat and everything. What a contrast to Egypt with all of its plush, you know, because of the Nile River flooding, it had all types of foliage and crops and foods and the great pyramids and the buildings, temples, all that. And of course, he was being trained to be in all the ways. He was trained to be a Pharaoh, Stephen tells us in the book of Acts. So we know that that's true. And the Bible also says now, you know, that even when we were studying through Genesis, that the shepherds were an abomination to the Egyptians. That's Genesis 46. So he's doing what he always thought was an abomination, or what he was taught was an abomination at least. But he's doing it. It's all preparatory. It's all God preparing him for the future, for 40 years. You know, humility is absolutely necessary for any leader. Meekness and brokenness. He was broken. God called Moses on an ordinary day, and God will not warn you when that day comes for you. He doesn't say, tomorrow at 10 o'clock, I'm going to show up and there's going to be a burning bush for you. No. No, it's always a surprise. You have no idea when it's going to happen. You don't know. It's unexpected. It's a source of revelation. God's choice doesn't always make sense to us at the moment. Amen? Doesn't make one bit of sense. I'll give you an illustration. At age 16, the Lord called me into the ministry at Falls Creek, and I started preaching my church at First Baptist Church in Jones, Oklahoma. They let me preach on a Wednesday night, and so I really got ready for that. You know, I really studied and everything. I remember that sermon very well. I entitled it, Kill the Umpire. It's all about Jesus when he was going to the cross, how they were all yelling and screaming at him and, you know, just like kill the umpire and that type of thing. I thought that was that. And then from some way, I have no idea, I preached all the way through the Bible from Genesis to Revelation in 15 minutes. I mean, I went through the whole thing. I thought, now what I'm going to do? I preached the whole Bible and I've still got a little time left. What's the deal here? I mean, that's it, folks. The whole Bible's been preached to you. Well, when you're young, those things happen. Well, I went around town because I mowed lawns throughout Jones, and I knew where all the preachers pretty well lived. And I went to most of their houses, and I asked, hey, you need any preaching done? Just give me. Now, you got to keep in mind, I'm a tall, skinny, freaky looking, because when I played football, I wanted everybody to think I had long hair. So I want to look like Joe Namath, because I thought I'm going to be the next Joe Namath. Had it sticking out my helmet. And pimples, I mean, it was terrible. But I would walk up to the, hey, preacher, are you needing preaching done? I'm your guy. I remember Pastor Felix, the Methodist pastor, he said, well, Dan, I think that's, or Danny is what they call me then. He said, but why don't you go back and play more sports for a while? No, I got other stuff to do. So ultimately, I kept reading the New Testament. And as I did, I saw Jesus preach wherever he was, and so were the disciples, et cetera, where Paul was. They just preached. So I started going to Oklahoma City and preaching. And I was preaching there, and I preached there for 2.5 years in the streets of Oklahoma City. If I ever get fired from here, that's where I'll go. I mean, I can preach anywhere, amen? You don't have to have a congregation to preach. And so my congregation were runaway kids and winos and hippies and people from all kinds of things there. So, I mean, oh, yeah, it's pretty fun. Well, sometimes it was. There were always things happening. But pretty soon, I started OBU and when I graduated from high school, and I was still preaching in the streets off and on, preaching in revival meetings and things. And God began to use me, and doing youth revivals. The Jesus movement was still going and all that. And so it was a great time. And I got out of school on Friday at OBU, and our Jones was down at Falls Creek. I'd already surrendered to the ministry by that time, but I drove down here for Friday night to, just be with the kids, and I knew that these are all my friends and everything, so I went down there, and I helped lay the blocks for that building. In fact, we had our own cabin down here, so I went down there, and Warren Hulkren, he's a fine preacher, he's pastor of First Baptist Tulsa, Dr. Warren Hulkren, and I'm not sure his sermon was actually Gage for Teenagers. It was an entire sermon on monotheistic Trinitarianism. And I'm not sure these kids underneath that big tabernacle with their hormones all raging got into that. And after it was over, I went out on the ball field that was right there to B.B. McKinney Chapel there, went out in that ball field, and I just start preaching because I'm used to preaching outside to people, and I just start preaching like a house on fire. And pretty soon I had 300 or 400 or 500 kids all there, and I'm just doing what I normally do. It's no big deal. Well, pretty soon here comes the guards, and they say, we've already had our sermon. You got to stop this. And so, we can't have too much of the Bible here at Falls Creek. So let's stop, so we can get out here and start necking in the pavilions. And so, I didn't tell them that because they were pretty upset with me for doing that anyway. So I'm walking away, and pretty soon, some pretty young lady walks up to me, and taps me on the shoulder, and I turn around, and she's got some of these other people with her, and they want me to come to Shattuck and preach a revival in the football stadium and some things like that. And I said, sure, I've already got a team of people. We do this. I've done some things like that, so it's no problem. And so that was great. I'm walking back to the cabin. I don't know if I've ever told Jeannie this, but I actually told her. I told Ray Jean Chesser, who was with me. I said, Ray Jean, did you notice that girl's nose? That's the prettiest nose I think I've ever seen on a girl. Now, I haven't dated for 2 years since I went into the ministry. I had to, it was just a miracle. so I had to stop. But then I went out to Shattuck, preached to an in the football stadium, and it rained. We moved into the gymnasium, and one night I looked over, and there she was underneath that basketball goal in there, and I mean, I woke up. Boom! I was planning on being the Apostle Paul. And I preached out there for them numerous times. Her dad was pastor First Baptist Church Shattuck, so I preached for him numerous times. And so on January 1972, I asked her to marry me in front of the WMU, and I didn't know what the procedure was on that. That's the first time I ever asked anyone to marry me. We're both 18 years old and freshmen at OBU, so I drive out to Shattuck to ask her dad if, and I know him well now because he's let me preach and everything, and I've helped him slop hogs and all kinds of stuff. So, but we were, but he said no. I said, wait a second. Well, he thought we were too young, you know. And at first I wanted to say, I don't care what you think. I'm going to do it anyway. You know, that's kind of, but no, that's not from the Lord. And so I said, we'll wait. If God's in this, it'll all work out. But what my point is this, I wasn't planning on going to Falls Creek. Had no idea. Because I had other stuff to do. But just on a Friday afternoon, I said, I think I'll run down there and spend the night, come back tomorrow with Jones. And I had no idea. Usually I probably wouldn't have preached down there in that field. But because Dr. Halkern is a great man of God, but he was way up in years and didn't connect with these kids, I just decided to jump out there and do it myself. And she heard me, and one thing, and now guess what? We've been married 52 years, amen? And my point is, that was a burning bush. I just didn't know it was burning. I just thought, on the last moment, I think I'd just go down to Falls Creek, because I never, you know, wanted to be with those kiddos. But you see how God worked that deal? Do you think that happened by accident? God's got stuff like that going in your life right now. Just open your eyes and see the burning bush. Amen? Because it's happening. If we'll just let God show us what he wants to do. Let me continue on verse 5. Then he said, do not draw near this place, God said to Moses. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. Now, I was going to just wear sandals, but I didn't. But so he's telling him to take his sandals off. He's up here by the burning bush. He's on his face, so he takes off his sandals. He said, don't get any closer till you get these sandals off. Well, because it is a holy place. So because of that, he does that. But I think there's more to it. And the Lord showed me this the other morning. I didn't read this in any book or anything, but you remember this beautiful story of Ruth. Ruth, she was a Moabitess. I mean, she was cursed. She was out. She was outside the covenant, but she comes back with Naomi. All their husbands are dead. She comes back. Said, "Where you go, I will go. Your God will be my God," etc. So she comes back, and she's gleaning in the field. And Boaz shows up and goes, "That's the prettiest nose I think I've ever seen." No, he said, "Who's that woman over there?" That's exactly what happened to me, and. But he can't redeem her back because he's not, there's a nearer kinsman than him. So he sees that man at the gate and he said, you know, she's come back with Naomi. Now you have the right to reclaim the land and et cetera, Elimelech's land and all that. But he said, but remember, you've got to marry Ruth. And the guy said, he didn't say that he would not. The book of Ruth clearly states that we don't know exactly what his name is or anything, but he said, I cannot. I'm not capable of doing that. And took off his sandal and gave it to Boaz, who is a picture of Jesus Christ, because Boaz is the great-grandfather of King David, who ultimately his lineage produces Joseph and Mary, and hallelujah. Amen? Amen. Does that make sense to you? Moses is a picture of the law. He is the lawgiver. God will give him not only the Ten Commandments, but the entire Torah, and he writes it down. He said, you will be God to Pharaoh for me. He is a picture of the law. But the law can show you your sin, but it cannot save. So he says, take off your sandals. You can't save anybody, but this burning, this fire in this bush can save all of Adam's lost race. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Get those sandals off as fast as you can. Quit trying to do it yourself. Recognize it's not you, but it's his holiness. It's him what that's doing it. Amen? I tell you what, if you really understood what I just said, you would go on a holy run. I tell you, it makes me just want to go nuts to think about that. No, we can't save ourselves. Get your shoes off. You're incapable of doing it. It's not that I might want to redeem, but I cannot redeem. Only the Messiah can do that. Amen? Well, where's that in the Bible? Well, thanks for asking. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16 and 7. Therefore, we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, but it is for a moment, is a working for us a more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Yes, at age 40, he was ready to be used by God, but God had to put him on the backside of the desert. And at age 80 now, he's about to be used by God again. You know, I like verse 4. So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him in the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. Why did he say it twice? I don't know. I have no idea. So I just thought I'd ask you, see if you knew. The Bible says, in the mouth of two witnesses shall a thing be established. Maybe that's it. I have no idea otherwise. But just when we think God has forgotten our name and address, he calls us. Amen? By name. He knows your name. Wow. He knows how many hairs are in your head and in your wig, too. He even knows your actual color that you used to be. And then he said, do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. It was an audible voice, just like with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The burning bush is not consumed. God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers of the prophets, Hebrews 1:1. God principally speaks through his word, what we're teaching through today. But be open to God to communicate with you in ways which are unusual and unpredictable and sometimes quite different. God will bring you to places and do things for you. And it came to pass when the sun went down and it was dark that, behold, they appeared a smoking oven and the burning torch that passed through the pieces of animals, that it was a blood trough. Quite different, unusual. You find that in Genesis 15, 7. But God spoke to Abraham, and he did all that. But God's the only one that could walk through it, not Abraham. He said, man can't do it. Man can't. You can take your sandals off, but only God can save. Amen? Amen. He chose unusual means to speak not only to Moses, but to Abraham, to us. He can do it because he loves us. Maybe you're hard-headed, and normally, you don't listen. That's what my parents told me all the time. I know one thing. If I was out playing or something as a little kid, and I heard my dad on the front porch saying, Danny Lynn Maxwell, get in here. I know, hey, it's lights out. You better get there as fast as you can and be as nice as you can be, because He used my name, the whole name, you know. So if he just said, oh, come on in, son, that's one thing. But when he used Danny Lynn Maxwell, it's time to hurry. Moses hears God's holy name for the first time. We're going to see that. Notice verse 6. So he asked, who are you? He said, I am Yahweh. That's that name. And in the Hebrew text, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for though he was afraid to look upon God. No moment in the life of Moses compares to this one, when he came without sandals on his face before God. God reveals his name to this 80-year-old man who had been trained to be a Pharaoh and now just a shepherd taking care of his father-in-law's sheep. Dear friend, the name of Almighty God is not mere identity. God's name resounds in his character. God is not spoken as if he did to Moses. For 200 years, God has not spoken yet. And the last conversation he had was with Jacob. Folks, dear people here at Chisholm Creek, I love you so much, but we deal with the same God today as Moses did. Nothing's changed. Who addressed Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? That means one undeniable thing. He keeps his promises and his covenants and his plans. No matter what we say or do, he is not deterred from what he's going to do. Amen? Notice verse 6 moreover, he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face. He was afraid to look upon God. Oh, because God is absolutely holy. Now, he's going to give some excuses. I'm only going to give you two of them. There's five of them. He's going to excuse himself because he doesn't feel worthy. Let's start verse 7. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt. I've heard their cry because of their taskmasters. For I know their sorrows. So I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up from the land to a good and large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey. May I say he hasn't changed that today and what's going over there right now. We are to be praying for the nation of Israel and ask God's hand and blessing on them. We did this morning back here. To the place of the Canaanites. That's who was in Israel at that time. They had taken over the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites and the turn out the lights. Oh, excuse me. But a bunch of these lights, you know, they're there. Verse 9, now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppressed them. Come now, therefore, I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Pretty clear, amen? But notice what, here's the first excuse, verse 11, but, everything's going pretty good until we see that but, all right? But, Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh, that I should bring the children of Israel out of it? Who am I? Now, folks, think with me. 40 years prior to this in Egypt, when he is identifying himself with the Hebrews, because his mother, you know, helped raise him, his real mother. Of course, he was the prince's son. But he sees this Egyptian beating up a Hebrew, and he feels so sorry for the Hebrew. He goes over there, and I don't know, in the scuffle or whatever, but he kills the Egyptian, and that was death to anyone. He wanted to lead them out then. 40 years old, 40 years from this point, he's 80 here. If you go back 40 years, he could have told you who he was. I'm God's flaming evangelist. You got a good deal when you got me, God. I'm ready to cook. Let's grow. He'd already taken over the entire Ethiopian army. He'd already overled them. He'd already done many things. He is a powerful, powerful man. Tremendous mind. One of my professors years ago said, next to the Apostle Paul, there's no question Moses had the greatest intellect of anyone in the Bible. But he also had great courage. And the Bible says, you know, he's sort of like me. He was very beautiful. No. But he said he was beautiful. Remember the fact they all turned around and looked at him. He was so nice looking. So, you know, when you see that movie with Charlton Heston, that's probably not too far as that goes. But here he is. 40 years. He's, who am I? 40 years ago, he was God's flaming evangelist. But there was a death of a vision. 40 years ago, but God said, I've got to put you on the backside of the desert because I've got to teach you. I've got to break you before I can use you. Jesus one day took two fish and five barley loaves. A little boy chose to bring it to me. There's about 30,000 people. You got 5,000 men, the Bible says, but you it would be another 5,000 women and all the kids. It'd be 20, 25,000, maybe 30,000, who knows, all together. But the only one that brought him, you know, he said, well, let's feed them. The disciples freaking out. They don't, how can we feed such a mass of people? A little boy brought two fish and five barley loaves. Now, he didn't bargain with God. He didn't say, well, all right, Jesus, here's one fish, and I'll tell you what, I'll give you three loaves. I'll keep two loaves and one fish. How's that? I'll share. He gave it all. That was the greatest miracle that day. The greatest teacher in all the world taught for a long time to 30,000 people, but one little boy got it. No matter how little it may be, you add that to Jesus, and it's more than enough. Amen. So he gave it all. But what did the Lord do? He took it. You give everything to God, he'll take you. And then he took his carpenter-trained hands on that bread and fish, and the Bible says he broke it. After he blessed it, he broke it. And then he used it to feed a hungry world. You say, Pastor Dan, I want to be used by God. I said, great. Surrender your total self to him. He'll take you. He'll bless you. But he'll break you before he'll ever use you. Amen? And that's what he did with Moses. He broke him. He doesn't even know who he is now. 40 years ago, yeah, but not now. Who am I? Who am I? I tell you who you are. You're a zero with the edges rubbed off. You're a nothing. That's who you are. What he was saying is, I'm incapable. I can't do it. Like God didn't know that. Of course, he can't do it. But he thought he could. And one day, that's all, he was ready to go for God, but one day he figured out, after killing the Egyptian, hey, I can't do this. Self-confidence at 40. But, you know, there was a scribe that came to Jesus one day, and he said, I want to follow you. And Jesus looked at him and said, foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath no place to lay his head. He said, you better think this over. He was humbled. He was obedient. Thank God. You know, God is substantial, folks. Philippians 4:13, wherever God guides, he always provides. If he's guiding you, he'll provide. It's not who you are, it's whose you are. That matters. Amen. Go, therefore, and make disciples unto all the world, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Then I will be with you, saith the Lord. I'm always with you, even to the end of the world, the Bible says. Wherever you go, God will be there. Psalm 139. And then the second excuse he gives is, I'm unknowledgeable. I just don't know. Now, When he was 40 years old, he was trained in all the ways of the Egyptians. The Egyptians had many gods, and he knew all their names. He knew all their names. For example, Apis was the god of the bull, or the golden calf that they made back. You know, that was one of their gods. Ra, spelled R-A, was the sun god. Orisus, he is the god of the Nile. And then Heka, that's one of my favorite, the frog god. You know, pretty soon we're going to have a showdown of these gods with the true God. And that's coming up. But he knew their names, but he doesn't know God's name. And God said, I'll tell you my name. I am that I am. You know, that's a noun with no object following it. What he is saying is this: whatever you need, I am. I'm already there. Amen. I am the self-existent one is what that means. I am the eternal one. That's what that means. We know our past is secure. Our sins are forgiven. God has done a work because how do we know it? Because he's the great I am. Amen. We know our future is secure in heaven. God has done that work. How do we know it? Because he's the great I am. We think our present is insecure, but God wants to work now because he's the I am now. Ever and all becoming one. I become to you whatever you need, Dan Maxwell. It will never change one iota. I am. Amen. Wow. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord our provider. That's one of his names. Jehovah Tiskanu, which means the Lord our righteousness. Jehovah Shema, the Lord is there. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. Jesus appropriated to the name I am 7 times in the Gospel of John and then alerted it to himself. I am, Jesus said, the bread of life, John 6. I am the light of the world, John 8. I am the door of the sheep, John chapter 10. I am the good shepherd, John 10, 11. When we hear plain commands, we become reluctant if we are not knowledgeable that God is the one who equips us and no one else. God is the I am. God is what we need more than we need another breath of air. More than another heartbeat. More than anything this world needs. We need God. Oh, hallelujah. He wants to equip Dan Maxwell. He wants to equip you to do the work that he's called you to do. God effortlessly predicts the future. Isaiah 46:10, declaring the end from the beginning, from the ancient times, things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. As I had a special time with God back here, my burning bush this week, early in the morning, I wrote this down and I put this as the application for this sermon. This is what I wrote, and I think God was kind of guy. It's not scripture, don't get me wrong. Of course not. But this is what God gave me, and it was that many great Bible scholars translate the name of God. I already knew this. I will be what I will be. That's probably the best way you can break down the great Yahweh I am. This means that God is active and reveals himself to Dan Maxwell, to you, only in his relationship with us, amen, and his activity in our lives. The name of God is not a password to memorize or a secret word to get us into heaven. No, no. God gives us his name to us in active relationship between a father and a child. Moses would learn for 40 years what that name means now till he's 120 years old. I can walk into Egypt, and with that name, I'll walk out with those children of Israel free. We'll walk through the Red Sea. I can see God telling Moses, so you killed one Egyptian. Going to teach you for 40 years, and after that I'll show you how to take care of Egyptians. Amen. Do it my way. Years ago, when I was telling you a little bit about my life early on, I'll just go back and finish with this, and we're done. I came home from being a lifeguard at Lake Texoma Lodge. I was 17 years old, been preaching for about a year, and I couldn't wait to go up to Oklahoma City and start preaching back in the streets. I've been preaching all in little Baptist churches the whole summer. The pastor of the Cumberland Church, where my grandparents lived by Lake Texoma, he got me into every church around that area down there every Sunday. So I took all the shifts I could off any other of the lifeguards so that I'd always be free on Sunday. I got home, and it was about almost 2 weeks, not quite 2 weeks, because school back then didn't start till after Labor Day, if you remember those days. But my mother took this magazine called Look or Life or something. It started one of those things. And it had Chuck Smith's picture on the front, baptizing in the ocean. I read that whole article. It just flamed me up. Oh, good night. I was about what that was happening out there in Calvary Chapel. So I had a plan. I thought, you know, hey, wait a second. I could drive out there. I got enough time. I could drive out there, spend a week there, and come back and finish school. But I know my mama, there ain't no way, Jose, that's going to happen. But with my dad, there might be a chance. So Daddy got home from Tinker. I showed him the article after supper. I always do it after supper. I need all the help I can get. I prayed about it because I really want to do this. And I said, after he read it, and it was a pretty interesting thing about what God's doing out there, and I just wanted to see it. So he said, well, okay, I read it. What do you want? And I said, well, Dad, I'd like to drive out there and spend a week. I want to see this. I mean, they have 1,000 people saved a week. Look what God's doing there. It's amazing. He said, your mama's not going to like this. I said, that's why I'm talking to you. He said, let me think about it. He went to work the next day. He hadn't talked to me. I knew I better just leave it alone. I thought, well, it's a dead cause, but at least it was shot. Next day, he came home, and he said, okay, I'm going to let you do it. And there's some conditions. One, you got to call when you get to Albuquerque. You got to get your car all fixed up, and when you call me when you get to Albuquerque, when you get there, you call us. Call us on the way back. And he said, now, I know that when you are going out there, God's going to tell you to pick up hitchhikers because they were all over, at that time. And so he said, just tell God you can't do it. Your dad won't let you. Do you understand? And then he looked at me one more time, very serious. And I knew my dad was serious because he was bald and his head would wrinkle when he got a little upset. And he looked sort of like a prune. And so he said, no, Danny, I know you're going to get out there, you're going to get all fired up, and you're going to want to stay out there, which means I'm going to have to come out and get you, which means that's not going to be very pretty. I said, yes, sir, I know fully well. And we shook hands. I'm coming back to finish high school. And I went out there. I remember getting there, and it's just a big old tent. And no place to sit. It was just tarps on the floor. So I'm in there. I don't know anybody. I'm just a kid from Jones, 17 years old. You know, I'm sitting in here. I've never been hardly anywhere in the world. And there they are. The live song is playing rock and roll. I like rock and roll, so that was fine with me. And it was, you know, about the Lord. And then walked in this elderly lady. And she's going to preach. It's not Chuck Smith. I thought I drove 1,700 miles to hear my grandma preach. Good night. Hallelujah. I was so stupid. It was Corrie Ten Boom. And she spoke. She was a member of that church. And she talked about the concentration camp, her family dying, how God got her out. And there is no pit so deep, he is not deeper still. That was her message. I stood in line for an hour, and while I'm standing in the line for an hour, this guy walks up to me, looks like Jesus. Of course, everybody out there looked like Jesus then. So he walks up, and he asked me if I have a place to stay. I said, no. So pretty soon, I got a place to stay at the Philadelphia House. It's a discipleship place. And if I wash dishes and mow the lawn and go out witnessing with, I said, hey, I'll pay you money to let me do that. You bet. So I now got a place to stay. I'm still standing in line. I get up to her. Finally, she grabs me when I get there, my head. She doesn't ask my name or anything and begins to shake me. At First Baptist Jones, we don't do much of that, okay? This is quite different. But she's praying and shaking at the same time. Said, oh God, this young man's come a long ways. And he wants to get a word from you. Said, oh God, burn it, burn it, burn it inside him. And finally, when she finished praying, I looked up at those old eyes of hers. She looked right square to my young, 17, stupid face, pimpled up, long hair, Joe Namath-looking hair. And she said, by that time she asked me my name, I told her, said, Danny, I'm going to tell you something, and I never want you to forget it. I said, yes, ma'am, what is it? Give God all your if onlys. I didn't know what that meant really, but I do now. I have used it thousands of times in the counseling room. If only this hadn't happened, if only this, if only. Give God all your if onlys. Oh, praise God. We were in Israel in 2023. We were going through the Holocaust Museum. I've been through it so many times, and it's kind of a deal that you just have to walk through at your own pace. It will tell you all the things. So you don't need anybody to help you, really. And I saw some others, had coffee with some of them, but I went out to the side where they have these Zionist trees, and I found her tree. She's been long gone now. And there it was. It was starting to sprinkle. And I knelt down at her tree, the Corrie Ten Boom Zionist tree there at the Holocaust Museum in Jerusalem. And I thank God for that dear lady who shook that young boy's head, had no idea, and said, give God all your if onlys. And I wrote right there in the dirt about her tree, give God all your if onlys. And I said, thank you, God. And I end with this quote from her. And just think about everything we've talked about Moses here and listen to Corrie Ten Boom, what she said. Never, quote, never be afraid to trust an unknown future into the hands of a known God. Don't be afraid to trust an unknown future into the hands of the God of the I Am that you know. Any bush will work, friend. Any bush. It doesn't matter. Because it's the bush is not the issue. It's the fire in the bush. Father, thank you for these dear ones. Thank you for this day. Thank you for all you do. I pray, God, speak to our hearts today. If there's someone who's never said yes to you today, may they do it. May others that are Christians say, oh, God, may your fire burn solely in my soul. Oh, God, you are the great I Am. You're everything I need in everyday life. Oh, God, thank you. Thank you. We're going to stand in a moment. If you're not sure you're saved, if you died, you go to hell. I want you to come forward. Let us pray with you and nail that down for with you and call upon the name of the Lord and let that great name of I Am save you today. Maybe you need to make other decisions. You just need to say, I need to start saying, I need to give God all my if onlys. Give your future, even though as unknown as it is, because you have a known God who is the great I Am. Do it today. Father, take this message. May it bring glory to you. In your name we pray. Let's stand. I'll meet you here at the front. Mom, Dad, teenager, we're singing You Becoming quickly.